UAA, College of Business and Public Policy.
What a business education has done for me, it's taken me out of poverty. This is what I was born into. This is a shack. We had no running water, no electricity. There was an outhouse on the hill. There was no heat. There was just a wood stove that we used for cooking, and my parents were functionally illiterate. This is where I live today. This is a beautiful home in West Anchorage that my wife and I designed. Our position in life today is we have this home. We have two relatively new vehicles. We are 100% debt-free. We want for nothing, and we are in a position where we are able to have whatever we want for the rest of our lives. So how did I get from here to here? And the answer is one word: education. I am privileged to have a bachelor's degree from UAA and a master's in business administration from Pepperdine University in Southern California that I earned while living there for 4 years. My area of education that I focused on was business, because we're surrounded by business in the world. I don't care what profession you're in, you're part of a business. And with that business knowledge, the fundamentals that I learned from UAA, the application of those fundamentals that I learned at the master's level, and taking that and being able to apply it, has resulted in success, comfort, financial success. I would, in the case of my bachelor's degree, it took me 15 years to earn it. A message I would leave to any other students is, if you start, don't give up. The master's degree only took 16 months, so figure that one out. I must have gotten smarter. But the reality is, just keep working at it, and the rewards are tremendous. I've had successful careers because of that education: 20 years in oil company marketing management, and 10 years as the chief operating officer of a civil engineering firm here in Anchorage. I have also, I'm also currently a part owner of a network of 12 Chevron service stations and convenience stores in Anchorage, Eagle River, and Palmer. So, obtaining a university and applying it is the key, the formula for getting out of poverty, having a successful career, and a comfortable retirement.
I think the big thing will be to use your advisors as a resource. We're connected to almost every department on campus, whether it be the health center, tutoring, student clubs, department and faculty. So if you can't find something and you know you need to talk to them, financial aid, you know, admissions or something, contact your advisor and we can at least get you in touch with who you need to be in touch with and talking with. And going off of that, we know it's a lot to balance, we know it's a lot to navigate, it's a ton of information being thrown at you. So we want you to be successful and we're here to help you. But it's really important as a student to become a self-advocate for yourself and ask questions if you need, problem solve a little bit, just try and find things on your own necessarily. If you can't find it, you know, then contact your advisor. But, you know, there's directories, there's lots of information on the website. So become that self-advocate and try to problem solve and own your degree and own your experience. We want you to be successful and we're here to help you. But this is really your degree and your effort and time and motivation to finish and, you know, do your classes and do your homework and all that good stuff. Read your syllabi. Some professors require attendance, some don't. Some have papers, some have presentations, some have projects. So, you know, read your syllabi, know the expectations, check your email, be proactive, ask questions, anything really to, you know, be in control of your experience as a college student.
Well, I like to frame it this way. Think about somebody in your life that you're spending 3 to 6 hours with a week. Maybe it's a good friend, a family member, somebody that you hang out with on social media, playing video games, doing snip, snap, chit chat, whatever y'all may do. And that's a person that you trust, who has your best interest, and it's a good relationship because there's bilateral communication, meaning communication is flowing back and forth between the two of you. Now think about a professor. You're going to be spending 3 to 6 hours a week in some form or fashion, face-to-face, via Zoom, doing work assignments, tests, and things of that nature. Why wouldn't you want to have an effective relationship with them? We already have your best interest in mind, but that interest is amplified when we know more about you. So why is it important? I'm gonna give you 3 reasons. There may be more, but I'm going to give you 3 reasons why it's important to build that relationship. First, research indicates that a student's academic achievement is improved in the classroom. You may be wondering why. Because if I know what motivates you, if I know what you aspire to, and what your learning style is, I can meet those needs that way. Second, another reason is that we are able sometimes to recognize your human capital. And what I mean by that, skills that you may not even know that you have. To give you an example, I had one student come up to me, Dr. Nelson, can you help me with my resume? Sure. Tell me what experience that you have. She said, well, I work at a yogurt shop and I'm not the manager, but at night I close up, I reconcile the money. Also, I'm responsible for helping to train other employees. I said, okay, stop right there. There's 2 skills that you don't even know that you have. First, you do not have to have the formal title of manager to be considered a leader. You're showing leadership because your boss is trusting you to close each night and to reconcile the money. 2, you have great interpersonal skills. Otherwise, why would you be training people? So don't just say I work at a yoga store. That's human capital that you're not even recognizing. The 3rd reason is that your professor can be a source of social capital for you. There are numerous times as professors, we get employers sending us emails, say, do you have anybody that for this new job position? If I don't know anything about you, if we haven't communicated, I can't recommend you. Just 2 weeks ago, a student came to me and they said, Dr. Nelson, I need you to, will you write a recommendation for a scholarship? Hadn't seen this kid in 2 years, but do I remember him? You darn tootin' I did. Here's why. He came to class, he came on time, he was prepared, he read the syllabus, he came to office hours, and he was really invested in his academic career. So there may be times when you need somebody to write you a recommendation to get in grad school, a recommendation for a job. This is where you come for this. We are happy to do this if we know you. So you're probably saying, well, what's the first thing I do to start this relationship? First day of class, walk into that class, shake it, put out your hand, if you're COVID-free, and introduce yourself. If you can't do it in person, do it by email. Introduce yourself by email before class starts. We remember these things. Then show up in class, prepared, ask questions, and participate. And you know what? Those office hours are there for a reason. Drop by and see us.
Sure. So I worked as a consultant, and one of the things that we did was a lot of interviewer training. So how to make interviews more reliable, more valid, get better data so you can hire the right person for the right job. And one of the things that we told interviewees was to use the STAR method. So the STAR method stands for situation, task, action, and result. So what was the context? Why did you have this project? Was it a school project? Was it something with a sports team? What was the actual task that you were given to do or you assigned yourself to do? What actions did you take to achieve that task? And then what was the end result? Another thing that we always told interviewees was to come in with a couple sort of pre-thought out answers to common questions. So one of those questions would be, tell me about a time you had to work on a challenging project. Why was it challenging? What things did you have to figure out? How did you set up timelines to make sure you had prompt deliverables? The other question that we see a lot in interviews is, tell me about a time that you had to work with a challenging colleague, coworker. And I think our natural reaction is to say, oh, hey, I'm super nice, I'm super personable, I get along with everybody, I don't cause fights. But that's not actually the answer that most employers are looking for. They actually want to know that you can work with challenging people, that quite frankly, there will be people that you won't get along with. But how did you tackle that situation? How did you make it about the problem and not about the interpersonal relations? So it's always good to have those questions in your mind. You can have them thought out using the STAR method, and it makes you look like a really good interviewee.
I think dealing with difficult people, or if it's a person in a situation, I think being calm is number one. Be calm, be honest, listen to them, and give them the time, and make sure they understand you're listening, you're hearing what they're saying. You know, even repeat back, I hear you, you know, I hear it, I understand, I sympathize with you, if that's appropriate to say. And then try to, you know, calmly explain where you're coming from too, and just keep it calm. I think if you can do that, then it doesn't get escalated, it doesn't go to the next level, you can just, I think most people want to solve a problem, and if it's solvable, sometimes things aren't, sometimes there isn't the fix, but most people don't want to be aggravated, annoyed, and upset. They want to find that solution. So being calm and listening and doing your best just to put yourself in their shoes while you're trying to think of how to communicate to would be helpful.
So within the Department of Economics and the College of Business and Public Policy more widely, we focus a lot on teaching people not just out of the textbook, but teaching people how to learn. So within my own field and within my own department particularly, I have more experience there, we spend a lot of time learning how to process new information, how to learn the latest techniques from research as they're actively being developed, and where those questions can be answered. Because our goal isn't to teach people the techniques of today, and not to teach people the techniques of 5 years from now, but also teaching people what techniques they're going to need to learn, the techniques that they're going to need in 10 years, 5 years from now. That makes sense. So we don't want to teach you what you need to know today. We want to teach you how to learn how to do those things in the future. And so in CBPP, that includes taking courses that are quantitatively heavy, where we learn things like computer programming, but not just out of a textbook how to do it. How to teach yourself these languages in the future as these technologies change rapidly. Because of course, I don't know what we're going to be teaching in 10 years, and I don't know what the business world will look like in 10 years. But I can teach you how to teach yourself so that you'll be ready. And that's also one of the reasons why continuing education is such a huge part of what we do here, from our graduate degrees to staying engaged with our alumni, to sharing what we're learning with the public in service, and also as just a, sharing our work with the public and our research as well through active seminar series and other outreach efforts. Because our goal isn't to just teach you what you need to do today, but to teach you into the future what you need to know.
Well, it depends on the industry and the job and the purpose of why you're working for them. You know, some employers, it comes down to just the basic fundamentals. Will you show up on time? Will you be appropriately dressed? Will you be able to pass a P-test? Those are some pretty basic expectations for most employers. You know, and that's something that is really, really important in terms of understanding those basics. These are known as soft skills in the academic world, but I like to call them professional skills. They are, you know, this is from a book that I read that, you know, really I think does a better job of couching what these skills are all about. And it's teamwork, it's, you know, basic, you know, time skills and time management skills and the ability to follow instructions and to ask questions when you're not sure. Not to try and, you know, fudge your way through something, but to actually interact with those who are supervising you to make sure that you know exactly what it is they expect of you. Because that's the main thing that you're trying to do as a new employee. You're trying to meet expectations. Now, there's an obligation on the employer's part to give you the resources that you need to be able to meet that expectation, to be clear in the guidance of what those expectations are, to give credit where credit is due, and to, you know, to provide you with the authority to do what you need to do. But in the same hand, you have to have the expectation of your employer that they're going to give you those basic needs, and then they have an expectation from you, besides accomplishing those things, that you are an interactive and very, you know, critical thinking team member, and that you can, you know, get out of them what you need to where you understand what it is that you need to accomplish. From an educational point of view, it depends on the industry that you are in. I have seen many great employees who come into a job and they're really good at the skill level that was expected of them when they first come on the job, but then they never evolve. They never go out and try to enhance those skills. And unfortunately, they get left behind and become less and less important in the team structure, if it's a team, or to the guy who's managing you because you're a, you know, an entry-level carpenter and you should be advancing in your skills. And so there's an obligation on you to always be learning. Always be learning on the job, always be learning from experience, always remembering the lessons of experience. You know, in my office, our motto is, it's okay to make mistakes, just don't repeat them. Learn from them and avoid them in the future. And I think that you start to take on this kind of mindset that you've got a responsibility as an employee to contribute your willingness to learn, to contribute your willingness to ask questions, and to contribute your willingness to commit to meeting expectations, you're going to be very successful in what you do. If you're just there because you want the money and you have no sense of real direction and you don't really care, then you probably don't, you're not going to last. You're not going to last in that job. You might be able to skate by for a while, but pretty soon they're going to notice that you're skating. And that is the one thing that a boss doesn't like, is having a skating rink in the middle of his office. So, you know, I think that those are just some pieces of advice that I would give anybody just getting started out in the world of work.
That's a great question. I myself am an entrepreneur, and I've launched startup companies, built their businesses, raised their investment, and sold them. I'm a fellow of the National Academy of Inventors, and I've written a book on entrepreneurship. So I am delighted that you are interested in entrepreneurship and cultivating that particular mindset. So if we look at entrepreneurs that everybody knows, like Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, Elon Musk, what do they really have in common? So they're all very creative, they're all leaders, they have a fire within to succeed, very important, and they saw a need and they built a company around that need to satisfy it. So if I were to give you some points about cultivating that, first, believe in yourself. That's very important, and that will really define whether you succeed or not. So if you believe in yourself and you encounter failure, that's okay, because you'll learn from that failure and you'll be able to adapt and move on. Also, be flexible, especially in times of challenge such as COVID. Companies that have been able to maintain success in many instances were able to pivot, establish a new business, or maybe pursue something they put on hold, but it made more sense now. So being flexible is very important. Establishing relationships with other entrepreneurs, absolutely, because you can learn from their successes and you can learn from their failures. Within that, find a mentor, because if you find a mentor, they're going to really help a lot. And let me give an example. Ed Knopf was my mentor. He was the founder of the Titan Corporation, which he started in his garage and built it to a multi-billion dollar corporation. I had the fortune to be his vice president. And when I told him I wanted to start my own company in biometrics, he agreed to be my mentor. But he not only was my mentor, he also invested in my company and he was on my board of directors. So if you choose the right mentor, you too could have that experience. And the other is stay motivated. When you first start, you're really excited and you have that motivation, but keep that motivation, because that, now how would you keep that motivation? Just think about what your company would do 3 to 5 years from now, right? Is it on the right track? Do I have to change things? How am I going to achieve my goal? Keep your eye on the end game. So I hope those pointers really helped you out. And entrepreneurs, by the way, are the innovators of this country, and startups actually create the most businesses in the US. So keep that in mind. And if you have more questions, please contact me. You can go to the College of Business and Public Policy website. And the last thing that I'd like to leave you with is that you are the future entrepreneurs of this country. So go for it.
Visit us at business.uaa.alaska.edu.